All praise is due to Allah, and may Allah raise the rank of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and protect his nation from that which he fears for them. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, let us first have the proper intention in our hearts to attend the lesson for the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All those sitting in the mosque, let us have the intention of i'tikaf while we are in the mosque. Last week we gave you an introduction about the importance of acquiring the knowledge about religion and how important the knowledge of the religion is for one to be able to differentiate between what is right and what is wrong, what is valid and what is invalid. Without the obligatory knowledge, one won't be able to know if he is performing the acts of obedience as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered. When you want to pray, you need to make sure that you are praying as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, صلوا كما رأيتموني أصلي. Pray the way you saw me praying. So it's not how you think the prayer is. That's why you need to learn what are the integrals of the prayer. Many people are unaware of the integrals. An integral is an important part of the prayer. It's part of it, without which the prayer is invalid. And there are 17 integrals for the prayer. So if you do not fulfill these integrals, your prayer is not valid. For purification, there are conditions that you must observe to make sure that your purification is valid, and so on. And the most important thing is the matters related to aqeedah, the creed of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the belief in Allah and His Messenger and what follows. Because one needs to make sure that his belief in Allah is correct, his belief in Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is correct, his belief in the angels is correct. So without learning about these matters that pertain to the creed of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, how would you know that you have the right belief about Allah and about the Messenger and what follows? Many people do not know the meaning of the two testifications of faith. They might be saying La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah many times a day. But when asked about the meaning of the Shahada, that's the gate of Islam. Anyone who wants to embrace Islam would enter Islam from this door, from this gate, the two Shahadas. Many people do not know the meaning of the two Shahadas. And due to the importance of this part of the knowledge, which is classified as personal obligatory knowledge, meaning every accountable person, everyone who is sane, pubescent, must learn and must acquire this portion of knowledge. Without that portion of knowledge, one will be classified as a major sinner. Because without that portion of knowledge, he wouldn't be able to make sure that he is praying properly, fasting properly, performing Hajj properly, and so on. That's why the scholars were keen to identify that portion of knowledge to people so they can learn them. And we have chosen for you a very famous and widespread book authored by the righteous scholar Sheikh Abdullah Al-Harari Rahimahullah. He passed away in 2008, spending a century, 100 years, spreading the knowledge of Islam, teaching people. Even when he was sick, at times when he was sick, he never used to lay back and not give attention to those seekers of knowledge. He would give lessons day and night. And when he is by himself, he used to praise Allah Azza wa Jal, read in the books of knowledge, and would spend his night praying and praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He dedicated his time to serving this glorious religion. Sheikh Abdullah Al-Harari, may Allah have mercy on him, came to Lebanon in around 1951. And he was surprised with the fact that many people were away from the knowledge of the religion. What they are concerned about is acquiring the worldly sciences, but not giving any attention to the religious sciences. When he found that people are far away from the knowledge of the religion, he put an effort towards teaching them the obligatory knowledge. And in doing so, Sheikh Abdullah chose a book for one of the scholars of Yemen, known as Abdullah ibn Hussein ibn Tahir, who died over 200 years. This scholar from Yemen, from Hadramaut, was very keen to author a book that would include most of the obligatory knowledge needed by people. This scholar was known for his righteousness. It was mentioned that he would say La ilaha illallah every day 25,000 times. Then Ya Allah 25,000 times. Then Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim 25,000 times. He wrote a book called Sulam al-Tawfiq ila mahabbatillahi ala al-tahqiq. That book was welcomed by the people of Yemen. So they started learning that book, and some scholars wrote explanation for that book. And because many regions these days are influenced by the Yemeni scholars in the past, because in the past many of the scholars of Hadramaut from Yemen, spread Islam east and west, north and south. They reached India, part of Pakistan and Bangladesh. They reached Malaysia, Indonesia, Thailand. And they reached east of Africa. And because they are Shafi'is, those scholars of Yemen, they spread the madhab of Imam al-Shafi'i in that region. Until this book had become very famous, that Muslims in these regions would endeavor to obtain this book. It contains about aqidah, belief, purification, prayer, fasting, pilgrimage, the obligations of the heart, then the sins of the heart, and the limbs of the body, then a chapter about repentance. Then he added also a chapter about Sufism, which is not part of the obligatory knowledge, but he added this so the student of knowledge can improve spiritually as well as he is learning. So not only learning, but he is working to improve spiritually, to have the manners the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam urged us to have. So this scholar, Abdullah ibn Hussein ibn Tahir, wrote this book called Sulam al-Tawfiq ila Mahabbatillah ala al-Tahqiq. Sheikh Abdullah found this book very useful and important. So Sheikh Abdullah summarized this book. And he called his book The Summary of Abdullah al-Harari, ensuring most of the obligatory knowledge. In it, Sheikh Abdullah tried to contain the obligatory knowledge, so he omitted the chapter of Sufism from the book of Sulam al-Tawfiq because he is summarizing. He changed few sentences and he might put a stronger saying in that book than what is mentioned in the original book. Then this book had become very famous as well. Hundreds of thousands have acquired this book and learnt from it. And many saw nice dreams about this book in particular. Some saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam handing in the mukhtasar, the summary, to people who were entering paradise. So they were lining up, entering paradise, and the Prophet was handing in that book to each one going into paradise. A lady as well mentioned to me that she saw in a dream that it was the day of judgment, and people were lining up, one line for hellfire, one line for paradise. And when it's the term, it's one by one. For a person, he would be asked either to go right to paradise or left to hellfire. She said, and my turn came. I was very nervous, full of fear, fearing that I might be ordered to go to hellfire. She said, then I saw a great illumination of light. Then that light became clearer, and amidst that light, I saw the book of the Shaykh. It's written, Mukhtasar Abdullah al-Harari. Then I was given that book. When I grabbed that book, I was ordered to go to paradise. In this book, it's a summary, meaning few words, but have many meanings. Everyone who is worried about himself should be keen to learn this summary, to make sure that he understands this summary, all of it. So he knows that he's praying properly, fasting properly, and so on. For that reason, we have chosen for you this book, The Summary of Abdullah Al-Harari, and will give a series of lessons from now on, trying to finish it as quick as we can, insha'Allah Azza wa Jal. Those who have acquired it before will refresh their memory. And those who haven't acquired this book will be taken to make sure they have fulfilled that obligation, which is to acquire the personal obligatory knowledge. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, طَلَبُ الْعِلْمِ فَرِيضَةٌ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ. فَرِيضَة, an obligation. طَلَبُ الْعِلْمِ فَرِيضَةٌ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ. Meaning, whether male or female, they have to acquire that portion of knowledge that is classified as an obligatory knowledge. Of course, if you want to pray, you need to make sure that you are praying properly. If you want to perform wudu, you need to make sure that you perform wudu properly. Not to only imitate those who perform wudu. It was narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was with his companions in a travel. Then some people rushed to perform wudu. And because they were in rush, some missed washing the heels in the wudu. You know, that back part of your feet. They were missing washing because they were in rush. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to them, وَيْلٌ لِلْأَعْقَابِ مِنَ النَّارِ. وَيْلٌ لِلْأَعْقَابِ مِنَ النَّارِ. Woe to the heels from that fire in hell. Meaning those who do not wash this part, the wudu will be invalid. If the wudu is invalid, the prayer will be invalid. So they might be thinking that they are making wudu, they are praying, when in fact nothing from that is accepted and nothing from that is valid. That's why you have to give attention. Now, we don't have the Prophet amongst us, but the companions had the Prophet amongst them, and he used to guide them in every case, in every matter, what to do, what is the right and what is the wrong. And they were very keen to fulfill the obligations, avoid the sins, and even perform the optional rewardable deeds. They used to give great attention to the religion. They would sit in the session of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as if birds are on their heads. If you have a bird on your head and you don't want it to fly away, you don't move. So they would sit and listen without even trying to get distracted in the slightest manner. They want to learn. They want to benefit themselves. Everything they learn, they put it into action, implementation. That's why in a short period of time, they improved a lot. When did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam receive the revelation? At the age of 40. When did he die? At the age of 63. How many years in between? 23. In less than 23 years, some of the companions have already reached the highest level of righteousness. There is no awliya righteous that are better than those ones who lived with the Prophet, learned from the Prophet. How they improved that quick? Because they were very keen to learn and implement straight away. Now, these days, many people would be sitting in sessions, in lessons, but their hearts are somewhere else. Their hearts are attached to something else. They're not in the sessions So they can learn something and they start practicing that thing. They might be feeling that they are pushed by their parents to attend or by their friends to attend, but their hearts are not into religion. When one's heart is attached to religion, he will be trying not to lose focus when he is in the lesson, not to be distracted by phone or by anything else. Why? Because he is willing to learn so he can implement, so he can be amongst those who are winners on the day of judgment. This is how the companions, in a very short period of time, improved a lot. Imagine from what? They were not born Muslims. Some used to worship idols. From idolists, from worshipping other than Allah, to the best righteous people ever in history. Because after the prophets, amongst the human beings, come those ones, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Talha, Zubayr, Abdurrahman ibn Auf, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, and so on. Those come after the prophets. In this nation, the awliya of this nation, in the previous nations, there were awliya as well, righteous Muslims, but not better than Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, radiyallahu anhum. None from all the followers of the prophets had reached their rank. So imagine after the prophets, who comes in rank amongst human beings? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. What a great honor. Then Umar, then Uthman, then Ali radiyallahu anhum. Those righteous Muslims are the best awliya amongst the human beings. In less than 23 years, they have reached that rank because they were very serious in learning, in implementing. So if everything you learn about, you put it into implementation, imagine to what extent you would have been improved by now. Just if you learn to say a dua, to do something, and you start practicing, so by now you would have been a righteous Muslim. But usually we ask Allah to forgive us who are lazy. We are lazy. We are dragged away by worldly matters. So even if we try not to think about them, we find ourselves indulging in these worldly matters. Although our life, you know, is very short, very, very short. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala summarized our life in three shortest ayahs of the Quran. مِن نُطُفَةٍ خَلَقَهُ فَقَدَّرَهُ ثُمَّ السَّبِيلَ يَسَّرَهُ ثُمَّ أَمَاتَهُ فَأَقْبَرَهُ. That's it, finished. مِن نُطُفَةٍ, from that mixture of both semen and liquid, the human being was created. فَقَدَّرَهُ, created a head for him, hands, limbs, body. ثُمَّ السَّبِيلَ يَسَّرَهُ, facilitated a way out for him from the womb of his mother. So he came to this world. What's next? ثُمَّ أَمَاتَهُ فَأَقْبَرَهُ. Then Allah inflicted death upon him and facilitated for him to be buried. In three short ayahs, these three short ayahs summarize our life on earth. مِن نُطُفَةٍ خَلَقَهُ فَقَدَّرَهُ ثُمَّ السَّبِيلَ يَسَّرَهُ ثُمَّ أَمَاتَهُ فَأَقْبَرَهُ. If our life is that short, should we indulge in worldly matters and neglect the religious matters? We shouldn't. What do we have to do? Start with the obligations. Start with the obligations. Allah Ta'ala said in the Qudsi Hadith, وَمَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ عَبْدِي بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّا افْتَرَضْتُ عَلَيْهِ. Meaning, if you want to be accepted by Allah Azza wa Jal, start with the obligations, not with the optional, rewardable ones. Start with the obligations. Make sure that you perform all the obligations. Then you start performing the optional, rewardable deeds. This is how you do it. And look at yourself. Evaluate yourself every now and then. See if you are doing the correct thing, the right thing. If you are improving in religion, or you are not improving. If you are not improving, that means you have a problem. Now, if you have a sickness, you go to a doctor, specialist, will give you medicine. We'll say you take 2 tablets a day, let us say for 1 month. Then you come back after 1 month, no improvement. What does he do? He gives you another medicine. If that didn't work, maybe this one might work. Because he is observing you. If he doesn't see that improvement, he gives you another medicine. But here, there is only one medicine. We know it. The cure for ignorance is knowledge. The cure for not performing the obligations is to perform the obligations. And that's 100% the cure for you. So you know it. So if you are short in knowledge, acquire that knowledge. If you are short in performing the obligations, make sure you perform all the obligations. If you are committing sins, stop doing these sins. The cure is very clear and obvious. All what you need to do, flick the cloak of laziness away from you, as they say. Don't be like a rusted, let us say, piece of gold, but it has all the dust around it. You as a Muslim, you are a piece of gold. But many people, unfortunately, are rusted, and they need to put effort to rectify their behavior and their life to make sure that they are doing the right thing. So for that reason, inshallah, we'll start with this book and we'll explain it in series of lessons, inshallah. The author said, may Allah have mercy on him, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, which means I start with the name of Allah in authoring this book. Allah is a name of God that only God can be named with that name. The name Allah is specific for God. Allah is a word in Arabic. It's a name that is not derived from any verb. So it's not a derivative of any word. And that word, Allah, means the one who is attributed with Godhood, which is the power to create, to bring things from the state of non-existence into the state of existence. That's why when we say no one is God except Allah, in other words, we are saying no one can create except Allah. No one can bring things from the state of non-existence into the state of existence except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now look at the technology these days. It's way advanced. People in the past maybe would faint if they see the level of technology we have these days. But just imagine one loses his finger in a machine. They cannot put a finger for him the same way from flesh and bones and the veins inside and the nerves and the way it functions. Look at the limbs they put now, the artificial limbs. They don't work as the original organ that a person has. Never. Bones, flesh, nerves, skin, you can feel. All these things with this little organ, we do not create, we are created. Allah is the only one who creates. So when we say no one is God except Allah, meaning no one creates except Allah. No one has the power to bring things from the state of non-existence into the state of existence except Allah Azza wa Jal. And that's why Allah is the only one who is rightfully worshipped. Because Allah is our creator, He's the only one who deserves to be worshipped. So when you say, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, I start in the name of Allah. And because the Shaykh is authoring a book, it would mean starting writing the book by mentioning the name of Allah for a blessing and following the Quran, because Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is a verse for every single chapter of the Quran except for one chapter, Surah At-Tawbah or Bara'a. But the rest of the chapters 113, they all start with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And the scholars took this custom from the way the Quran, that Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is at the beginning of every chapter. So they started the books by writing Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim at the beginning. Ar-Rahman, the one who is merciful to the believers and non-believers in this world and to the believers in the hereafter. Ar-Rahim, the one who is very merciful to the believers. We are here to work for the hereafter. We are here to prepare ourselves for the hereafter. We are created to worship Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah said, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, to order us to worship Him. Not to eat, drink, sleep, and get married. Look at the animals. They eat, drink, sleep, and they mate. So what's the difference between you and an animal then? We are here to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Praise be to Allah, the Lord of the worlds, the owner of whatever came into existence. The one who is attributed with life, Al-Hayy. The one who does not come to an end, Al-Qayyum. And the one who decreed all the creations, including their acts, sayings, and conditions. There is no speck that moves without the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything that occurs in this world is by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every speck that moves, every fine dust that you see moving in the beam of the light, it's moving by the will of Allah. Every wave of the ocean is moving by the will of Allah. The wind, also moves by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every leaf of a tree that falls off to the ground, it falls off by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So everything is controlled by the power of Allah, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ma sha'a Allahu kan, wa ma lam yasha' lam yakun. So if Allah did not will for something to happen, it will never happen. And whatever Allah willed for it to happen, it shall happen. No one can stop it or delay it or defer it. It will happen at the exact time and in the same way that Allah willed for it to happen. Not a slight change. Now, with all the technology they have, they leave a gap for error. And they say, possibility of error 0.00 whatever. Yeah, because the error could happen. We hear about medical errors these days. Medical errors, machines not working, failing to work. Yeah, because those are not creators. So they are subject to errors. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with His perfect will and perfect power, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is managing and controlling this whole universe with everything in it. I ask Allah ta'ala to raise the rank of our Master Muhammad, his good and pure al and companions, and to protect his nation from that which he fears for it. Thereafter, Sheikh Abdullah says, this book is a summary inclusive of most of the obligatory knowledge that every accountable person is in need of and is obligated to know. This comprises the obligatory knowledge pertaining to belief, and that's the most important part. Issues from purification, tahara, up to pilgrimage, meaning take the chapter of prayer, fasting, paying zakah, pilgrimage. So that portion of knowledge. And some rules of dealings, like renting and hiring. You need to learn about them if you want to engage in any of these contracts. Qirad, which is to trade with another person's money for profit sharing. You invest your money with someone else for profit sharing. There are conditions for it. Now, people might indulge in these dealings and contracts without even learning about what they are allowed to do and what they are not. Collateral. When you put something as collateral against a debt, and the like, along with showing the rules of riba and some forbidden sales, according to the school, meaning mazhab of Imam, the famous mujtahid, Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i, al-Qurashi, al-Muttalibi, may Allah raise his rank. Imam al-Shafi'i, radiallahu anhu, is the founder of the school of al-Shafi'i. That's why it's called al-Mazhab al-Shafi'i, after him. And his mazhab is widely spread east, west, north and south. Hundreds of millions of this nation follow the school of Imam al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu. He's the one, as Al-Bayhaqi and others mentioned, meant by the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, عَالِمُ قُرَيْشِ يَمْلَأُ طِبَاقَ الْأَرْضِ عِلْمًا. A scholar from Quraysh will fill the earth with knowledge. And he was the only one that description applies to him. He is Qurashi from Quraysh. He is Muhammad ibn Idris, ibn al-Abbas, ibn Uthman, ibn Shafi', ibn Sa'ib, ibn Ubaid, ibn Abd Yazid, ibn Hashim, ibn al-Muttalib, ibn Abd Manaf. That's where he meets with the lineage of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then Ibn Qusay, Ibn Kilab, Ibn Murrat, Ibn Ka'b, Ibn Lu'ay, Ibn Ghalib, Ibn Fihr, Ibn Malik, Ibn Nadr, Ibn Kinana, Ibn Khuzaymah, Ibn Mudrika, Ibn Ilyas, Ibn Mudar, Ibn Nizar, Ibn Ma'ad, Ibn Adnan. Up to here, that's the lineage of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, up to Adnan, that's confirmed. The scholars agreed on this lineage up to Adnan. After Adnan, there is no authentic narration to state the lineage of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam back to Prophet Adam alayhi salam. So Imam al-Shafi'i radiyallahu anhu meets with the lineage of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at Abd Manaf. At Abd Manaf. Abd Manaf had Hashim and al-Muttalib. Hashim is the grandfather of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, great grandfather. Because the Prophet is Muhammad, the son of Abdullah, the son of Abdul Muttalib, the son of Hashim. Hashim is the son of Abd Manaf. Imam al-Shafi'i's lineage goes back to Abd Manaf, al-Muttalib. Al-Muttalib was the brother of Hashim. That's why they call Imam al-Shafi'i al-Muttalibi. They call him Al-Muttalibi because he goes back to Al-Muttalib, the son of Abd Manaf. He is also known by Al-Shafi'i, and that is after his great-grandfather that we mentioned, Shafi', the son of As-Sa'ib, and both were companions. Because Shafi', one of his great-grandfathers, was a companion, son of companion, Shafi' ibn As-Sa'ib, he was called Al-Shafi'i. He was born in Gaza, in Palestine. They call it Gaza to Hashim. Some said he was born in Yemen. Some said in Asqalan. In the year 150. And he died in the year 204. So he lived 54 years, and his knowledge is spread amongst hundreds of millions these days. The obligations of the heart, sins of the heart, and of other organs such as the tongue and the different parts of the body, such as abdomen, eyes, ears, hands, private parts, and feet, are also included. And this book is concluded with a chapter about repentance. So it's important. Every part of it is important. The original book, as we explained, from which the author took his summary, is called Sulam al-Tawfiq ila Mahabbatillahi ala al-Tahqiq, written by the Hadrami Faqih scholar, Abdullah ibn Hussein ibn Tahir, the son of Muhammad, the son of Hashim, Al-Shafi'i Al-Alawi. He was called Al-Alawi because one of his ancestors was called Alawi. So he was named after him as well. So who is famous amongst his ancestors, he would be attributed to him. Born in the year 1191 after Hijrah and died in the year 1272. So it is about 160 years from now. Many precious issues were added to the book to clarify its contents. On the other hand, what the author of the original book mentioned of Sufism, as we mentioned earlier, which is not part of the obligatory knowledge, was omitted. Some sentences were changed. to make them clearer in such a way that the subject would not be changed. In a few cases, they also mentioned what some Shafi'i scholars like Imam Sirajuddin Umar ibn Raslan al-Bulqini, he's one of the top scholars in the school of Imam Shafi'i, they call them Ashabul Wujuh, and some mentioned that he reached the level of Ijtihad. He reached the level of Ijtihad, Sirajuddin Umar ibn Raslan al-Bulqini. He was born in the year 724 after Hijrah and died in the year 805 after Hijrah. So what Al-Bulqini preponderated, meaning what? He gave more weight to some sayings. Because in fact, the author of Sulam al-Tawfiq took most of his information from Ibn Hajar al-Haytami. And Ibn Hajar al-Haytami used to rely on the sayings of Imam al-Nawawi more than al-Rafi'i, and both are in the rank of tarjih in the school of Imam al-Shafi'i radiyallahu anhu. So the scholars did not say in every case that al-Nawawi goes against al-Rafi'i, we take by the saying of al-Nawawi, no. In many cases, that's the case. But in some cases, al-Rafi'i's saying has more weight, more compliant with the proofs. So not in everything, whenever al-Nawawi and al-Rafi'i disagree, we follow with what Imam al-Nawawi said. In most cases, that's the case, but in some cases, we take with what al-Rafi'i mentioned. Al-Bulqini is higher than them, is higher than al-Rafi'i and higher than al-Nawawi. He's from Ashab al-Wujuh, and some said he reached the rank of Ijtihad. Imam al-Bulqini disagreed with al-Nawawi in many cases. Because Imam al-Bulqini was in a stage or rank when he was able to deduce the judgment from the statements of the Imam. Bulqini came after al-Nawawi, and al-Bulqini disagreed with many cases al-Nawawi mentioned. So Sheikh Abdullah replaced some of the sayings of al-Nawawi with the stronger saying that al-Bulqini preponderated, gave more weight to. And he relied on what al-Rafi'i mentioned. Hence, the accountable one must pay attention, due attention to this summary of the obligatory knowledge by learning it, studying it, understanding and comprehending, repeating its cases until he memorizes them and until they have been lodged in one's heart, along with having the sincere intentions for the sake of Allah, in order to have one's deeds accepted. The author named the summary of Abdullah al-Harari, ensuring the personal obligatory knowledge of the religion, which is the knowledge that includes knowing about Allah, His Messenger, and other necessary creedal issues, and includes also knowing the rules of worship and other necessary knowledge. Since knowing about Allah and His Messenger and believing in Allah and His Messenger is the most important and best obligation, the author started the book by talking about the essentials of the belief, which we will leave till next week, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. We start with it after this introduction. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase our knowledge and benefit us with the knowledge we have acquired. Ameen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.